This time, during their encounter, Sada put the knife to the base of Ishida's private area and said she would make sure that he would never play around with another woman. Ishida laughed. Probably didn't believe her at that time. Hello everybody, I am back for the fourth installment of Deadly Women Around the World. And today's story takes place in Japan. We are going to tell the story of Sada Abe. Brace yourself, because it gets weird. Okay, we're going to start with her background. Sada Abe was the youngest of four children who survived into adulthood in an upper middle class family of tatami makers in Tokyo. Sada's parents were both described as honest and upright people. Her brother was a bit of a womanizer who ran off with his parents' money after his wedding. Her sister, Teruko, was also known to have had several lovers. Her father sent her to work in a brothel, which was not an unusual punishment for female promiscuity in Japan back then. Interesting. He did buy her back, and she soon married after, but that happened. Sada was born in 1905. Her mother encouraged her to take singing and shamisen lessons, both activities which at the time were more closely associated with geishas and prostitutes than with classical artistic endeavors. Geishas were considered glamorous celebrities, and Sada skipped school for these lessons. She started to wear makeup. She wanted to kind of embody the image of the geisha, if you will. With her siblings causing family problems, Sada was often sent out of the house alone. At 15 years old, during one of these outings, she was by one of her acquaintances. And even though her parents defended and supported her, she became a very difficult teenager after that. As she became more and more difficult, her parents sold her to a geisha house. They were hoping to find her a place in society with some direction. That was apparently a thing. Her experience with the geisha world turned out to be a disappointment. To become a true star amongst the geisha, she would have had to start studying arts and music as a young child. So she wound up a low-ranking geisha, and her main duties were basically the same as those of a common prostitute. She worked for 5 years as such, and eventually contracted syphilis. Since this meant she would be required to undergo regular examinations like legally licensed prostitutes, she decided to become one, as she would earn more money that way. She began in Osaka's famous Tobita brothel district, but soon gained a bad reputation. She stole money from clients and attempted to leave on numerous occasions, but was tracked down and brought back. After 2 years, she finally escaped the licensed prostitution system and began working as a waitress. But her earnings left her unsatisfied, and she was soon back at it, though now unlicensed. Following the death of her mother, she returned to Tokyo and took care of her father before he died as well. She then became the mistress of a man called Kazara. I'm really sorry for the pronunciation. Kazara was not able to keep up with her requirements in the bedroom department for long before he became exhausted, resulting in the pair splitting up and Sada fleeing to Nagoya to become a maid in a restaurant. She became romantically involved with a customer at the restaurant. His name was Goro Omiya, a professor and banker who aspired to become part of Japan's government or regime. Knowing that the restaurant would not allow their relationship to keep going, she returned to Tokyo, where Omiya encouraged her to become financially independent through opening a business and recommended that she start as an apprentice in such a business. So she took his advice and began working as an apprentice at the Yoshidaya on February 1st, 1936. The owner of the restaurant, Kishizo Ishida, 42 at the time, was known to be a bit of a womanizer. There seem to be a lot of womanizers in this story. So he pretty much left the restaurant in the hands of his wife while he started flirting with, you guessed it, Miss Abe. Omiya had never satisfied Sada in the bedroom department, and so in April, Ishida and Sada started their torrid affair. They met for a special kind of encounter at a tea house, the equivalent of a special kind of hotel, if you will. The couple remained in bed for 4 days. They then moved directly to another tea house, where they continued to drink and work out. They would continue even as maids entered the room to serve sake. Ishida did not return to the restaurant until the morning of May 8, 1936, so over 2 weeks later. His wife must have suspected something was going on. Sada later said of him, quote, "It is hard to say exactly what was so good about Ishida, but it was impossible to say anything bad about his looks, his attitude, his skill as a lover, the way he expressed his feelings. I had never met such a sexy man," end quote. After they separated, Sada began drinking. She claimed that with Ishida, she knew love for the first time and that the thought of him back with his wife made her jealous. She began considering the murder a week prior. On May 9th, she attended a play in which a geisha attacked her lover with a large knife. So on May the 11th, she bought some sushi and a kitchen knife. All right. She later described meeting Ishida that night. Quote, "I pulled the kitchen knife out of my bag and threatened him as had been done in the play I had seen, saying, 'Kishi, you wore that kimono just to please one of your favorite customers. You bastard! I'll kill you for that!' Ishida was startled and drew away a little, but he seemed delighted with it all, and they were back at it. This time, during their encounter, Sada put the knife to the base of Ishida's private area and said she would make sure that he would never play around with another woman. Ishida laughed. Probably didn't believe her at that time. 2 nights into their frenzy, Sada began choking Ishida, and he told her to continue, saying that it increased his pleasure. She had him do it to her as well, or so she says. On the night of May 16th, 1936, Sada used her obi sash. I'll insert here a picture of what the obi sash is. It's like the belt of the kimono. To cut off Ishida's breathing during his climax, and they both enjoyed it. They repeated this for 2 more hours, or so she says. Everything is alleged. Everything is in her confessions. Once Abe stopped the strangulation, Ishida's face became distorted. It would not return to its normal appearance. Ishida took, supposedly, 30 tablets of a sedative to try to soothe his pain, and he fell asleep. At about 2 a.m. on the morning of May the 18th, Sada wrapped her sash twice around his neck as he was asleep and strangled him to death. She later told police, quote, "After I had killed Ishida, I felt totally at ease, as though a heavy burden had been lifted from my shoulders, and I felt a sense of clarity," end quote. After lying with his body for a few hours, she cut off his attributes with the kitchen knife, wrapped them in a magazine cover, and took them with her, like in her purse or whatever it was that she was carrying with her. She left the hotel at about 8 a.m. after having put on his underwear and asked the staff not to disturb him. When asked why she did that, she replied, quote, "Because I couldn't take his head or body with me. I wanted to take the part of him that brought back to me the most vivid memories," end quote. After leaving the hotel, she met Omiya. Remember him? She had moved back to Tokyo and taken the job under his advice. She apologized to him. He assumed that she was apologizing for having taken another lover. He didn't know about the murder. But she was actually apologizing for the damage to his political career that she knew would inevitably occur when word of the murder would come out. On May the 19th, the newspapers picked up the story. Omiya's career was ruined, and Sada's life was under intense public scrutiny from that point onwards. Rightfully so, I might add. On that very day, she went shopping and saw a movie. She stayed in a hotel in Shinagawa on May the 20th, where she had a massage and drank a couple of beers. She spent the day writing farewell letters to Omiya and Ishida, amongst others. She was planning to commit 1 week after the murder, But in the meantime, she thought she'd try practicing a little necrophilia. I will leave this at that, if you don't mind. Then she decided she would flee to Osaka and jump from a cliff while holding on to her souvenir, if you will. I'm moving on with the story, but I am aware that this is all very disturbing. Okay, so at 4 p.m., police detectives came to her room. "You're looking for Sada Abe, right? Well, that's me," she said. When the police did not believe her, she displayed Ishida's stolen remains as proof. After her arrest, Ishida's stolen remains were moved to Tokyo University Medical School's Pathology Museum. They were put on public display soon after the end of World War II, which is a little disturbing in and of itself, but okay, only to disappear again. Poor guy. The first day of Sada's trial was November 25th, 1936, and by 5 a.m. crowds were already gathering to attend. One of the judges presiding over the trial admitted to being sexually aroused by some of the details involved in the case. What? Sounds so weird. And also TMI, and also a little unprofessional, is it not? He still made sure that the trial was held with the utmost seriousness, apparently. On December 21st, she was convicted of murder in the second degree and mutilation of a corpse. Though the prosecution demanded 10 years, and she claimed that she desired the death penalty to be reunited with Ishida, she was in fact sentenced to just 6 years in prison. In handing down the sentence, the judge explained his decision by stressing the role that Ishida had played in the events leading up to his death. He also discussed Sada's mental state at the time. Despite Sada's objections, her lawyer insisted that she had been insane at the time of the murder. The judge concluded that the sentence would be enough time for Sada to rehabilitate herself in prison and start a new life upon release. Sada's time in prison would represent the most stable period of her life. She would later describe the prison staff as loving and caring people, and actually felt herself part of a community. She studied Buddhist philosophy while in prison. Due to her being a model prisoner, her sentence was later commuted and she was released exactly 5 years after the murder, on May 17, 1941. The police record of Sada's interrogation and confession became a national bestseller in 1936. In the years since its publication, it became the most circulated female criminal narrative in Japan. All right. The writer Sakaguchi called Sada a tender, warm figure of salvation for future generations. Are you kidding me? Okay, I'm going to stop interjecting here, but come on. Kishizo Ishida's wife was devastated by her husband's death, although she had to have known about his affair. But she managed to keep the restaurant going. Ironically, the Yoshidaya restaurant flourished due to the publicity of the case. Even the inn where the murder had taken place attracted eager customers. Many couples specifically asked for the room where Ishida had died. Talk about disturbing. Sada capitalized on her notoriety by sitting for an interview in a popular magazine and appearing for several years in a traveling stage production. In 1952, she began working in a pub in downtown Tokyo. She lived a low-profile life in Tokyo for the next 20 years or so. Last seen in 1970, nothing else is known about her life. Occasional later rumors of her commitment or entering a convent came up, but nothing was ever confirmed. And that, my friends, is the story of Sada Abe. And wow, she killed a man, she mutilated his body, and then she became like an icon. Maybe I'm missing the point here. Like, Japan's political situation at the time was very tense, to say the least. And apparently this scandal came as a quote-unquote relief to the people from the news at the time. At least it's what I read, but I still find it quite disturbing. Anyways, if you like the video, like, subscribe, ring the notification bell. Thank you. That'll help my channel grow, and that'll let me know that you want more of this type of content. So we'll see you in the next one. Have a good one. Bye.